Good morning. Welcome to the Episcopal Church of the Epiphany. We're so glad we could be together. This is a busy day. Lots of stuff going on, so be sure to listen to the announcements because there are a lot of them this morning. And for our sermon, we are in our in-gathering where we've asked folks to bring their pledge cards and place it in the alms basin. Do it as a part of our regular giving. So if you give by check or you have $100 bills that you want to put in the alms basin, then do that along with your pledge card, and we'll appreciate that. A little slow to take on this morning, aren't we? and in our sermon today, Father Chris is going to be talking about generosity and giving, and we hear that a lot around here because that's true. But sometimes when we hear things regularly, they sort of go, we file by title, you know? And so he's going to break apart for us things that happen when we give generously. What are those things? Stay tuned. Please stand as we sing our processional hymn 594, God of Grace and God of Glory.
Thank you.
Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Thanks, my with you. Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, in Christ you have revealed your glory among the nations. Preserve the works of your mercy, that your church throughout the world may persevere with steadfast faith in the confession of your name. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated for the reading of the Scripture.
A reading from Exodus. Moses said to the Lord, "See, you have said to me, 'Bring up this people,' but you have not let me know whom you will send with me. Yet you have said, 'I know you by name,' and you have also found favor in my sight. Now if I have found favor in your sight, show me your ways, so that I may know you and find favor in your sight. Consider too that this nation is your people." He said, "My presence will go with you, and I will give you rest." And he said to him, "If your presence will not go, do not carry us up from here. For how shall it be known that I have found favor in your sight, I and your people, unless you go with us? In this way we shall be distinct, I and your people, from every people on the face of the earth." The Lord said to Moses, "I will do the very thing that you have asked, for you have found favor in my sight, and I know you by name." Moses said, "Show me your glory, I pray." And he said, "I will make all my goodness pass before you, and will proclaim before you the name, the Lord. And I will be gracious to whom I will be gracious, and will show mercy on whom I will show mercy. But," he said, "you cannot see my face, for no one shall see me and live." And the Lord continued, "See, there is a place by me where you shall stand on the rock. And while my glory passes by, I will put you in a cleft of the rock, and I will cover you with my hand until I have passed by. Then I will take away my hand, and you shall see my back, but my face shall not be seen." The word of the Lord. We will now read Psalm 99 responsively by whole verse. The Lord is king, let the people tremble. He is enthroned upon the cherubim, let the earth shake.
The Lord is great in Zion, he is high above all peoples.
Let them confess his name, which is great and awesome. He is the Holy One. Proclaim the greatness of the Lord our God, and fall down before his footstool. He is the Holy One. He spoke to them out of the pillar of cloud. They kept his testimonies and the decree that he gave them.
O Lord our God, you answered them in
proclaim the greatness of the Lord our God, and worship him upon his holy hill. For the Lord our God is the Holy One.
A reading from the second letter of Paul to the Corinthians. Each of you must give as you have made up your mind, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. And God is able to provide you with every blessing in abundance, so that by always having enough of everything, you may share abundantly in every good work. As it is written, he scatters abroad, he gives to the poor, his righteousness endures forever. He who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will supply and multiply your seed for sowing and increase the harvest of your righteousness. You will be enriched in every way for your great generosity, which will produce thanksgiving to God through us. For the rendering of this ministry not only supplies the needs of the saints, but also overflows with many thanksgivings to God. The word of the Lord.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Matthew. The Pharisees went and plotted to entrap Jesus in what he said. So they sent their disciples to him, along with the Herodians, saying, "Teacher, we know that you are sincere and teach the way of God in accordance with truth, and show deference to no one. For you do not regard people with partiality. Tell us then what you think. Is it lawful to pay taxes to the emperor or not? But Jesus, aware of their malice, said, Why are you putting me to the test, you hypocrites? Show me the coin used for the tax. And they brought him a denarius. Then he said to them, Whose head is this, and whose title? They answered, The emperor's. Then he said to them, Give therefore to the emperor the things that are the emperor's, and to God the things that are God's. When they heard this, they were amazed, and they left him and went away. The Gospel of the Lord.
In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated. So today is our last sermon of our stewardship of giving, stewardship season. And I would like all of us to just at least pretend to be on the receiving side. We all are on the giving side, but just pretend or just think about. And I believe that there were times in your life when you were on the receiving side of blessings. So just think about that you are on the receiving side of the blessings. In our gospel reading today, the question is raised, and Jesus answers the question. And it is, what is Caesar's? Give it to Caesar. But what is God's? Give it to God. The question that I would like us to carry along today as we look at our lesson from 2 Corinthians, what is God's? What is God's? Now, we understand that how many of you are involved in gardening? So anything, right? Gardening. How many of you count the seeds when you actually sow? Okay. How many of you, when the seeds are grown and the food and the produce is harvested, how many of you actually count the seed that how many seeds we got back? I mean, I don't know any person that OCD. But if you are one, I would like to shake your hand. The idea is that if we sow one pear or apple seed, when a tree grows, we usually have no idea that what is produced from that, how many seeds were grown out of that. Paul uses the imagery, the image of faithful giving or cheerful giving as an image of sowing. We are sowing a seed when we give as a cheerful giver. And we have no idea that how the seeds will grow. Let me ask you again, if you are a gardener, where do you get your seeds? Walmart? Whole Foods? Wherever you get your seeds. The idea is, do you know that who was the person who got you these seeds? We only get it from stores. Usually have no idea. Sometimes we get it from some person. And friend of ours or someone else says, these are the seeds of this plant I would like you to have. So we know. There's a circle. Someone receives the seed. And that person plants that seed. And more seeds come out of that with fruit. And then that person passes on the seeds. You got the seeds, because someone planted those seeds and harvested those seeds. You see, there's a whole circle. And Paul tells us who provides the seed. If you look at the reading, he says, God is the one who provides the seed. He is the one who gives you the seed so you can sow the seed, so you can reap the harvest, but you can also give the seed to others. So the process, the circle keeps going. In the Old Testament, in the book of Malachi, chapter 3, verse 10, we read there is a problem with Israelite not giving for God. Let me read this verse for you. It's Malachi chapter 3, verse 10. Bring the whole tithe into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. Test me in this. Listen carefully. Test me in this, says the Lord, and see if I will not throw open the floodgates of heaven and pour out so much blessing that there will be no room enough to store it. There will be no room to store it. Now, Israelites are not giving. That is a secondary problem that Malachi is trying to address. They are not giving, it's a secondary problem. The primary problem that he is trying to address is that you are not being faithful with what God has already given you. The concept behind giving is that it's not that God wants what we have. God is not asking us to give what is ours. God asks us to give him back that he has already given to us. He's not interested in our stuff. I mean, he is. In our talents and all this, but God only asked us to give back because he has already given to us. If you are giving a tithe, you receive 100%, 90% you can keep, 10% you are giving back. So God is not asking from us what is ours. He is asking that he has already given to us. So this is how the circle goes. God gives it to us, and we receive it and we harvest it, and then we give it back, part of that. And when we give part of that back, the circle keeps on moving. This is where Paul leads us. He says that what happens when we become a cheerful giver, not giving what is ours, just returning, giving part of that God has given back to the world. This is what Paul, look at the last verses, he says that for the rendering of this ministry not only supplies the needs of the saints, it not only supplies the needs of the saints. And if you stop there in giving, that you are meeting others' needs, you are not getting the full picture. The full picture is, he says, the needs of the saints, but also overflow with many thanksgivings to God. The end result is when we give cheerfully, the end result is thanksgiving to God and worshiping to God. Now, let me give you, do you all remember how much during the COVID last year we gave it to the network? Anyone remembers how much fresh produce we gave? We are not talking about everything else we give. Only from our garden. Does anyone remember how much we gave? No one remembers. Okay. It was about 23,000 to 24,000 pounds fresh produce from Epiphany's garden. 23,000 to 24,000 pounds that we gave. When we were talking about it, you know, the quantity and the size what we gave, you see, there was so much joy on the faces of people who contributed to that. I mean, technically, Epiphany contributed to that. But only few of us could see the faces of those people who received over there. I only remember that one day I took a lot of those fresh produce and I gave it to the people at Network, and they were so happy to see those produce. It's a joy that is passing on. From Epiphany to Network, just imagine those people who actually receive those produce. How joyful that one. You see the circle and the ripples of joy that keep going when we give as cheerful givers. How many of you have been international students? Thank you. We need to meet after that. Most of you missed that part. So when you are an international student, the laws of that country, you have no idea how this works. When we came to the US, because I'm an international student, no one from my family could work. I could not work, my wife could not work. We have no way to earn. We were given small on a stipend, and that stipend would take, after we take the rent out, we were left with less than $300 to spend the whole month. This is how we started living. I could only do one 20 hours job on the campus. Now, there are over 300-400 students on campus, and there are only like 20 jobs. Everyone is hunting for those jobs, and usually I'm not the best candidate for that. So we were in a situation that we did not have our house rent. We were $264 short of our house rent. We have no way we can get that money. There is no way. We don't know anyone. There are no people. All we could do was pray. So we prayed. We could not ask anyone to give us that money. The day is coming close. If you don't pay the rent, you all know, you don't have to be an international student to know that if you don't pay the rent, what's going to happen? So we are praying. And one morning, we wake up, and there is one envelope under our door. Guess how much money is there? $264 in that envelope. We don't know who sowed that seed in our lives. We have no idea. But the result was our faith was strengthened in the God who can provide. Not only our faith was strengthened, our first response was, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for your providence. We were thankful for the people. So we sent an email thanking whoever dropped that email, that envelope in our money. But at the end, the big channel is whatever we give as a joyful giver, whatever we give, the Lord has a way to multiply it. Being a joyful giver is not about just sharing money and meeting saints' need. It results in thanksgiving to God. It strengthens faith. And it leads people to worship God. So I would say, as Epiphanites, continue the circle. Do not break the circle, because we have no idea the smallest amount that we will give, how the Lord will use it to strengthen his worship. Would you pray with me? Lord, we look at our lives, and one question that lingers in our lives and must linger all the time: how we can pay you back for whatever you have done for us, not only in our providence, but also giving your son for us so that we can reap the harvest of eternity with you. Give us a joyful, cheerful giving heart for Christ's sake. Amen.
Please stand with me as we affirm our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed, which you'll find on page 358 in the Book of Common Prayer. Page 358. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
The prayers of the people, Form 3, can be found in the Book of Common Prayers on page 387. Father, we pray for your holy Catholic Church. Grant that every member of the Church may truly and humbly serve you. We pray for all bishops, priests, and deacons. We pray for all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world. Give us grace to do your will in all we undertake. Have compassion on those who suffer from any grief or trouble. Give to the departed eternal rest. We praise you for your saints who have entered into joy. Let us pray for our own needs and those of others, especially Paul Matthew, Casey Feel Lacey, Kathy Leonard, and those we now name. We pray for the repose of the soul for those who have died, especially Patricia Davis, Holly Dixon, and those we now name.
Almighty and eternal God, so draw our hearts to you, so guide our minds, so fill our imaginations, so control our wills, that we may be wholly yours, utterly dedicated to you. And then use us, we pray, as you will, and always to your glory and the welfare of your people, through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen.
Turning to page 360 in your Book of Common Prayer, let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways.
Almighty God, have mercy upon you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. Please stand and share the peace with one another. The peace of the Lord be always with you. All right, strap in your seat belts. We got a lot of notices, as the Brits would say. I would like to, at this time, have a couple folks come up, and we want to do a special blessing and appreciation for Vivian. Vivian has been caring for our flowers since the Garden of Eden. And she's going to step back from the leadership part of that, but she's not going. And so we want to bless her with God's blessing and express our deep appreciation of her. Hold your applause till we're done.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I'm Vicki Stevens, and I'm here with Vivian Brotherton and Mary Frances Love. I've been asked by Mary Frances to say a few words specifically about the Epiphany Flower Guild and about Vivian, the person who has led and directed the guild for over 20 years. While writing words comes easily to Mary Frances, and speaking words comes easily to me, agreement on the creation of just the right words to honor the humble person who has created thousands of beautiful floral arrangements has been more challenging. Here goes, Vivian. Epiphany is made up of many key ministries for which we are thankful. Floristry is the talent and ministry to which Vivian Brotherton has given much of her life and time and effort. Flowers which grace the altar at the great liturgical feasts and sacraments, when we are married, when we are buried, when we are ordained, when we receive communion, when we march to children's chapel, and when we are ushers. Flowers for shut-ins, flowers on desks, flowers even in the ladies' room. Vivian did this altar arrangement Friday for a funeral yesterday. In the coming weeks, she and members of the guild will work on two weddings to be held in this parish on the very same day. We thank her for her skills in design, in teaching, and as a mentor, and as well in the great mysteries of hydrangea coddling. As ever, this is a time of transition at Epiphany. Vivian has decided to reduce the scope of her role. She will remain as Flower Guild Directress Emerita and designer, but is passing the ministry lead to Mary Frances. Today, Vivian, in honor of your decades of service to the Epiphany Flower Guild, we would like to present you with a gold cross entwined with a rose. We thank you with words, with flowers, and with love. Ken and Neal, if you would please bless the cross.
Heavenly Father, we thank you for this cross. We pray that you would bless it with your blessing, that it would be a constant reminder as well as an enabler for receiving your love at this time. We thank you for Vivian, for all she's done, and thank you for her continued ministry among us. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. You may now applaud. God bless you. You want to say anything?
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. We love you, Vivian. So welcome to the Episcopal Church of the Epiphany. We're glad you're here. If you are new among us or if you have returned recently from a respite from church and you want to reconnect with us, please fill out a visitor's card that you'll find in the pew rack in front of you, or take the picture of the QR code that you'll find on the second page of our worship leaflet and follow those instructions and we'll connect with you. If you have a birthday or anniversary, birthdays on my right, wedding anniversaries in the middle, anniversary baptism on the left. We will invoke God's blessing upon you at this time. Anniversary, anniversary, anniversary. Shall we pray together? Heavenly Father, we thank you that by water and the Holy Spirit that you have bestowed upon these, your servants, the forgiveness of sin and have raised them up to new life through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Sustain them, O Lord, in your Holy Spirit. Give them an inquiring and discerning mind and heart, the courage to will and to persevere, a spirit to know and to love you, and the gift of joy and wonder in all your works. Thank you for their serving among us. Through Jesus, our Lord, we pray. Amen. Happy anniversary. Okay. Over here in the chapel, we have flu shots. And if you are a part of the Beatles group, when I'm 64. If you are 64 and below, please get your flu shot. It's no cost to you. 65 and older, you need to go to your doctor or a pharmacy. If you have not health insurance that covers the flu shot, then go on back to the chapel and they'll direct you to a place where you can get a flu shot. So do that, please. We have our in-gathering. What we want to do is when you see the offering plate pass you, go ahead and put your pledge card in there, as well as the if you have your pledge offering and a check, or if you have a spare $100 or $200 bill, then put that in there as well. A little faster at the second service than the early service. Thank you for that. And so we will be taking in our pledges at this time when we receive communion. And to encourage us and inspire us, Jeff Jones is going to come up and tell us about giving from his perspective.
Good morning, everybody. Happy in-gathering day. My name's Jeff, and many of you might know me as the other Jeff. We're now at the end of the stewardship campaign, and I'd like to thank all of you who've prayerfully considered how to generously pledge your time, talent, and treasure for next year. We call this occasion in-gathering, and we gather all of our pledges together, and we start planning for next year. As junior warden, I've had the opportunity to discover and review the past, looking at plans and records of the parish, and I've had the opportunity to see the great care and stewardship of this place. And this is my example of stewardship. With God's grace, we'll continue to be good stewards for the years to come. In this past year alone, we as a church have begun a new school. We've nurtured a new church in Wiley and increased our support for local charity organizations. We've improved our beautiful garden and campus, and we've taken a step of faith, and we're beginning to see the results of that faith. We can continue to serve the community with your help. And as many of you know, the Lord has blessed Epiphany with a wonderful staff. With faith and determination, they have kept the expense levels below what was budgeted for them at the beginning of this year. And for this, we're very blessed and grateful. We're all aware of what inflation is doing, higher prices in goods and services. The church is feeling that same pain. So please consider that when filling out your pledge card for 2024. And I feel it's important to tell you that budgeted pledges for this year are currently behind. This is not uncommon and would not normally cause a concern, as the church pledge income fluctuates throughout the year and usually balances out by the end of the year. Father Terry Reisner will begin his tenure as the new rector of Epiphany on the first Sunday of Advent on December 3rd. I'm sure that we will all agree that we would like to give him a fresh start. So I ask that you please prayerfully consider fulfilling your 2023 pledge as soon as possible. There are so many opportunities and ministries at Epiphany to share your time, talent, and treasure, and glorify God. If you're not involved, reach out and become a part of the community that serves God, their parish, and the community. Thank you, and thanks be to God.
All right, say 12:30. Say 12:30. 12:30. Say 12:30. 12:30. Say 12:30. God speaks in threes. What is 12:30? Who knows what 12:30 is? It's next week. Our trunk or treat starts at 12:30. Remember that. So after the service, don't just go on home, but hang around, and we'll have a wonderful time. It will be in the north parking lot. Say that. North parking lot. Again, only twice. North parking lot. So don't park in the north parking lot in the morning. Park in the south parking lot. And 12:30, north parking lot next Sunday. I may be coming as Gandalf. I've got the hair here, and we'll see. So let's see what else we have. We're honing in. There we have nominations for vestry members and for other categories of servants in our church, and the ballot box is next to the coffee. Everybody knows where the coffee is. Find the ballot box there. Please fill out your vote and place it in the ballot box. And do know that all baptized Christians are welcome to receive communion here at Epiphany. The way we receive is come forward to the communion rail, stand or sit as is most comfortable for you. The priest will put a wafer in the palm of your hand, so hold your hands like that, and you may then consume it, and then when the chalice bearer comes by, grab it by the base and take a sip of the wine. Or you may choose not to receive wine. When it comes, place your hands over your chest, again in the sign of the cross. Should you choose desire gluten-free wafers, then place one hand over your chest. Come at the end of the communion time, and we will provide gluten-free wafers for you. And then finally, we have the prayers for healing here at the communion rail following the service. So please come if you'd like to participate with the laying on of hands. Please come forward and assist with that as well. I think that's it. I don't see anybody trying to catch my attention. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God. We continue with Eucharistic Prayer A, which you'll find on page 361 in the Book of Common Prayer, page 361. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who on the first day of the week overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection, open to us the way of everlasting life. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Gracious Father, in your infinite love you made us for yourself, and when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. When he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. When he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, Alleluia, Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us. The gifts of God for the dearly beloved people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. The body of Christ. Turning to page 7 in our worship leaflet, together let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you, remain with you, and flow through you to bless others this day and always. Amen. Please turn to page 8 for our dismissal hymn, and just a note that the choir will sing the second verse, and the congregation will sing together the first and the third verses.
Let us go forth in the name of Christ.